الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلوات الله وسلامه على نبينا الأمين أما بعد. I'm your brother Abu Usama Al-Dhahabi and this is another episode from our ongoing series The Sunnah, The Better. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته to all of you. As we've discussed in our previous episodes, we've explained what the sunnah was, the importance of the sunnah, the danger of opposing the sunnah due to one's ignorance or due to one's arrogance, and a number of important issues that the Muslim needs to comprehend and understand in relationship to the sunnah of the Prophet of Al-Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Now, we will embark, by Allah's permission, on dealing with different ways in which the sunnah has addressed different aspects of the life of the human being. Because the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, he has come with the religion of truth to proclaim it over all other religions. And he has explained to the people what they need to do and what they need to avoid as it relates to receiving the mardat of Allah Ta'ala, Allah's pleasure. So we're going to take, inshallah, a number of examples from his practical life, those things that he did and he practiced and he called to. And all of them are from the sunnah. And at the top of the list, and we're going to deal with quite a few things and quite a few issues, inshallah, in terms of subjects. But the most important subject is the one that the Quran has placed the most emphasis on, and the religion of Al-Islam has placed the most emphasis on, and that is the sunnah of calling to a tawheed, the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal. The tawheed of Allahu Ta'ala is the single most important principle in the deen of Al-Islam, as everyone knows, or everyone should know. And it is the reason why Allahu Ta'ala has created mankind and why he has created the jinn. As he mentioned in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created the jinn and I have not created mankind except for the sole worship of me, Allah alone. And it is this tawheed that all of the prophets and all of the messengers, salawatullahi wasalamuhu alayhim, what they brought and what they called their people to. As Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, لَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. Verily, we have sent a messenger to every single nation, and each and every messenger told his nation and informed them that they should worship Allah and that they should avoid and they should refrain from giving worship to any and all false deities. So this tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal is the most important sunnah. As a matter of fact, if you were to combine all of the other sunnahs of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you were to put them next to this sunnah of a tawheed, this is the single most important sunnah that the Prophet came with, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Allah has mentioned something that I want to bring to the attention of our noble and respected viewers, and that is something that happened, and we would not have known about this situation had it not been for the Quran being revealed, and had it not been for the Prophet of Al-Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, coming and informing us of the details of this issue. Because it's something that took place in the ilm al-ghayb. We are now in the blessed month of Muharram. As a matter of fact, today is the second day of Muharram, the new Islamic year. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for all of our sins and our mistakes and our indiscretions from all of the previous years. And that establishes our hearts and our feet firmly upon the siratul mustaqim this year and the years that are to come, insha'Allah ta'ala. After we've completed the Dhul-Hijjah, the month of Dhul-Hijjah, in which the Hajj was performed and the people went to the house of Allah Azza wa Jal, and they established the oneness of the Tawheed of Allah, and they went to that place that is known as Arafah. And the Prophet said about Arafah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-Hajj Arafah. The Hajj is Arafah because of the significance of that place and because of the significance of that particular day. And what happens on that day? The point that we want to make here is we want to draw your attention to an ayah from the Quran in Surah Al-A'raf, in which Allah Ta'ala mentioned, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا أَنْ تَقُولُوا يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ. And remember when your Lord, He took from the loins of Adam, all of Adam's descendants, and He caused them to bear witness upon themselves. And Allah said to all of the descendants of Adam, Am I not your Lord? And they all collectively responded by saying, Yes, you are our Lord. We bear witness to this fact. Allah Ta'ala said, So that you, Bani Adam, won't come Yawmul Qiyamah and you claim we had no knowledge of this issue. We had no knowledge of your uluhiyah, the fact that you were the God that deserved to be worshipped. We had no knowledge of your rububiyah, the fact that you were the Rabbul Alameen and the Lord who sustains and provides for and takes care of all of his creation. So this ayat of the Quran establishes for us that Allah Ta'ala has taken the covenant or the mithat, as the Prophet says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from all of the children of Adam. And they bore witness upon themselves. وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. And Allah is enough as a witness against them. Concerning this particular ayat of the Quran, its explanation has been elucidated and explained by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in further detail. And what was collected by Imam Ahmed in his Musnad and other than Imam Ahmed from the ulama of al-Hadith, may Allah Ta'ala have mercy upon all of them. The Prophet says sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَخَذَ الْمِيثَاقَ مِنْ ظَهْرِ آدَمْ بِنُعْمَانْ يَوْمْ عَرَفَةَ وَأَخْرَجَ مِنْ صُلْبِهِ كُلَّ ذُرِّيَّةٍ ذَرَأَهَا وَنَشَرَهُمْ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ قُبِلًا أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Allah Ta'ala took from the loins of Adam all of his children, all of Adam's descendants. He placed them at Na'man, and he spread them out. And then he said to them, Am I not your Lord? And they all bore witness and said, Yes. This authentic hadith is the explanation of that ayat from Surah Al-A'raf, that it shows that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has informed us that Allah Ta'ala took all of Adam's children from his loins and they were placed at Arafah. So those of you who are viewing this program right now, although you have never performed the Hajj in Al-Islam, some of you, in fact, you have been to the place of Arafah. Every single human being has been to Arafah. When Allah Ta'ala took Adam's children and his descendants from his loins, he spread them out at that plain and he caused them to bear witness against themselves and upon themselves. Allahu Akbar. This is from the ilm al-ghayb that we don't know its reality and we wouldn't have known about it had it not been for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam bringing the deen of al-Islam. So this goes to show, brothers and sisters, in al-Islam, that every single human being, no matter what his religious persuasion happens to be, he should understand that Allah Ta'ala has a right over him for being the one who created him, who sustains him, who gave him life when he was nothing. He was created out of nothing, and Allah Ta'ala brought him into existence, and he provides for him. So how is it possible that an individual can come and he can take the ibadah of Allah and give it to the sun, or give it to the moon, or give it to someone other than Allah from his creation? Allah Ta'ala told us in an authentic hadith that's in the Sahih, that Allah Ta'ala said in the hadith al-Qudsi, إِنِّي خَلَقْتُ عِبَادِيَ كُلُّهُمْ حُنَفَاء فَجَاءَتْهُمِ الشَّيَاطِينَ فَاجْتَالَتْهُمْ مِنْ دِينِهِمْ فَهَرَّمَتْ عَلَيْهُمْ مَا أَحْلَلْتُ لَهُمْ. Verily, I have created all of my servants حُنَفَاء. Hunafa is the plural of the word hanif. And hanif actually means to lean towards something. The person who was hanif, Ibrahim is hanif, Musa hanif, Isa hanif, you and I, hunafa, insha'Allah ta'ala. So the meaning of hanif, for those of you who don't know Arabic, and this is one of the vocabulary words that every Muslim should know, or he should have at least heard about it before. Hanif means to be leaning. So why are we called Hanif or Hunafa? Allah created his servants, Hunafa, all of them are Hanif, because they are leaning towards the tawheed of Allah, towards the ibadah of Allah, and they're leaning away from kufr and shirk. This is the meaning of hanif. So in this authentic hadith, hadith al-Qudsi, Allah Ta'ala mentioned, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, verily I have created my servants, all of them, hanif. And then the shayateen came, and the shayateen changed them from their religion. And the shayateen made haram upon them that which I made halal. Allah Ta'ala had made on the people permissible for them to eat all kinds of issues. And then the shayateen come and the shayateen say, we can't eat that, you can't eat this. And they also did the opposite thing. They made halal what Allah Azza wa Jalla made haram. Allah made it impermissible for the consumption of pork, for the consumption of khamr or sharab. The shayateen came and they said, no, these things are permissible. So the shahid of this particular hadith al-Qudsi is that it goes to show that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He has created all of His servants, Hanif, and each and every one of them should pay homage to the ibadah of Allah Ta'ala by recognizing that fact. The Messenger of Allah, Sallallahu Alaihi Wa Alaihi Wasallam, went on to further illustrate and explain this particular concept when he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wa Alaihi Wasallam, Kullu mawludin yulidu ala al-fitra. فَأَبَوَاهُ يُهَوِّدَانِهِ أَوْ يُنَصِّرَانِهِ أَوْ يُمَجِّسَانِهِ Every single child is born upon the fitrah. And the fitrah is another one of those words like hanif that should be in the vocabulary of every Muslim. We should at least have heard of this word, the fitrah. فِتْرَةُ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَتَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا فَلَا تَبْدِيلَ لِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ It is the fitrah of Allah that He created the human beings upon it. And you won't find any change in the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal. What is the fitrah that Allah has created all of His servants upon? The fitrah is the natural disposition for the person to say La ilaha illallah. The natural disposition to look up to the sky and to know that Allah is above the heavens. When he wants to make dua, naturally his fitrah tells him, raise your hand and to look up to the sky. His fitrah tells him, don't look inside of your pocket to find, is Allah Azza wa Jal there? Subhanallah. His fitrah that he has been created upon is the natural disposition to know these things, his nature, if you will. So the Prophet told us, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah Ta'ala has created every single child upon the fitrah, and his parents make him a Jewish person, or his parents make him a Christian, or his parents make him a Magian. So this particular hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes to show, again, as we mentioned already, that every single human being, they have to worship Allah and Allah alone. Now the question may be presented by one of our listeners, especially from the youngsters, especially in light of the fact that this ayah or this hadith is talking about the young people and the way that they are born. So the young girl, the young boy may say, Ummi, Abi, Abu Usama said that the Prophet said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that every child is born upon the fitrah and his parents make him a Jewish person, a Christian person, or a Magian. How is that, Ummi? How is that, Abi? How is that, Abu Usama? Well, it's easy. There are different ways that a person can make his child other than Hanif and other than upon the fitrah of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala's creation for Bani Adam. A person can make his child, his fitrah corrupted by leaving the Muslim country that he comes from. He was born and he was raised in the Arab world or the Muslim world where he was surrounded by family members who said La ilaha illallah, family members who made salah. And even though some of them didn't pray, nonetheless, the institutions of al-Islam were still prevalent and they were manifested on a daily basis. And he saw what was good and what was bad. The girl, she grew up knowing the etiquettes of al-Islam. She had hayat, she was shy. She had ihtiram, she had respect for herself, respect for others. So many of the Muslims, we grew up in environments where many times the Muslims are not the best people in terms of practicing Islam, but because of the elements in the environment, you'll find many times they have some characteristics that are good. So you can destroy and corrupt the fitrah of your child or a person by changing his environment, by leaving the Muslim country and going to those countries where the people pay no attention to respecting the elders, respecting oneself, respecting the woman, respecting those people who are in positions of authority. That's one of the ways that a person's fitrah can be destroyed. Another way in which his fitrah can be destroyed is, although Allah Azza wa Jalla has allowed the Muslim man, I emphasize, it has the religion allowed him to marry a lady from Ahl al-Kitab, al-Yahud al-Nasara, and Islam allowed that. And it is not haram, although they may make shirk with Allah, and although they may put a Christmas tree in their house, and although they may do other practices that are against the religion of al-Islam, where there's shirk inculcated in their practices. Al-Islam has allowed that. Allah Ta'ala, He knows what He made halal and why He made it halal. It's not for us to debate these issues. The point here is, if a man chooses to marry a woman from Ahl al-Kitab, then he has to be careful. Because if he marries a woman from Ahl al-Kitab, he has to know that he runs the risk of his child growing up and his mother, the mother of that child, wants to have a Christmas tree in the house. She wants to give him presents, and she wants to tell him that Father Christmas gave him the present. And as a result of that, the child is going to be brought away instead of being hanif towards the ibad of Allah and the tawheed of Allah. He is hanif away from that and hanif going towards the shirk billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. The individual who, as a Muslim, he decides to marry a woman like the Sikh individual or the Hindu individual, it's not permissible in the deen of al-Islam for the Muslim man to marry a woman who commits shirk, that type of shirk. Although Ahlul Kitab commits shirk, Allah allowed it. Whereas the women from the other persuasions and the other religions, it's not permissible. So the Muslim man, he goes and he falls in love with a woman from one of these denominations or persuasions. And as a result of that, his child grows up and his fitrah is destroyed or corrupted, contaminated, diluted. So we all have a responsibility to our children to try and maintain and to protect their fitrah by marrying that Muslim woman who's on the sunnah, that Muslim woman who loves the sunnah, that Muslim woman who takes the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as her example. Because as we mentioned, the sunnah the better. As it relates to this issue of at-tawheed and it being a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wasallam, we should understand, ikhwani, the importance that the Messenger of Allah put upon this particular word and this concept. He told us sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wasallam, من قال لا إله إلا الله نفعته يوم من دهره. Whoever says لا إله إلا الله, one day, he is going to be benefited by that particular word. So the Muslim, no matter what he does in this particular hayat al-dunya, in this dunya, he drinks khamr, he falls into illicit relationships with men or women, he may do murder, even the greatest crime after ash-shirk billah. Whatever he does, as long as he dies saying la ilaha illallah, that word is going to come one day to benefit him. And it may be that he may not even go to the hellfire because he will be under the mashia of Allah. If Allah chooses, Allah will forgive him. And if Allah chooses, Allah will punish him. And if Allah chooses to punish him, eventually he's going to come out of the hellfire. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive any and every sin except shirk. As he told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran, قُلْ يَا إِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Tell them, O my servants, tell them, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O my servants, do not give up hope of having the rahmah of Allah. Those of you who have gone overboard and you've gone into excesses as it relates to your sins, don't give up the hope of the rahmah of Allah, no matter what you've done. For verily, Allah forgives all sins. Allah forgives all sins, as He mentioned in so many ayats of the Quran. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَنْ يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِي وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah will not forgive that you make shirk with Him, but He'll forgive everything other than that, no matter what it was. So if an individual from amongst us committed some major crimes and major sins that we should make tawbah for, especially that we have been blessed with a new year, oh Allah, forgive me and forgive all of the Muslims for what we've done last year and throughout our lives, and protect us from shaitan. The point here is, no matter what he's done, as long as he comes with the tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal, he's going to go to Jannah eventually. Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, min as'adu nas bi shafa'ati yawm al-qiyamah. O Messenger of Allah, from all of the human beings, who will have the most success and he will be the happiest, sa'id person from getting your shafa'a, your intercession? The Prophet told him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من قال لا إله إلا الله خالص من قلبه. The one who says لا إله إلا الله with إخلاص in his heart. With إخلاص. So this is important. It's not enough for a lady to say لا إله إلا الله and she doesn't wear hijab. لا إله إلا الله and he doesn't pray. لا إله إلا الله and he's a ظالم مجرم فاسق. That's not enough to be an individual who really is on La ilaha illallah. It has its conditions. And as we mentioned already, the statement of Allah Ta'ala, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. If you people really love Allah, then follow me. Follow the sunnah. Why? The sunnah, the better. If you people truly love Allah, then follow me. And Allah will love you. And he will forgive you for your sins. So la ilaha illallah, brothers and sisters, in the deen of al-Islam, it has its conditions, seven conditions. And we'll talk about that, inshallah, at another time. But we want to bring this segment to a close by touching upon how we find the Muslims compromising this issue of la ilaha illallah. We have a lot of compromises where we say la ilaha illallah, but we do a lot of things that are counterproductive and diametrically opposed to la ilaha illallah. There are those Muslims who say that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows everything. He knows the ilm al-ghayb, the knowledge of the unseen. This goes against la ilaha illallah. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Tell them, Muhammad, no one knows the unseen. No one in the heavens and the earth knows the unseen except Allah. So we have, unfortunately, those people from our ummah who come, and we have a lot of practices and comprehensions of the deen, the way that the kuffar of Quraysh, the non-Muslims of Quraysh, the mushrikun of Quraysh, the way that they used to be. Allah Ta'ala described this situation. And he, Tabarak wa Ta'ala, said in the Quran about them, وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَحْدُهُ اشْمَأَزَّتْ قُلُوبُ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ دُونِهِ إِذَا هُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. If Allah is mentioned by himself, they become upset and enraged, those who don't believe in the last day. And when those who are mentioned along with Allah, they become happy. Lo and behold, they become happy. This is not in accordance to la ilaha illallah. So we're going to bring this session to a close, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us the muwahideen, the people on at-tawheed and who are hunafa. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.